Well, hey, Jet people, welcome back to Jet City, Jet City Turbine Services Incorporated, where we used to build fighter jet engines for the Sabre jet, and now we're kind of drifting. We're taking a break. But anyway, I guess I'll start off with this. I'm a professional jet engine mechanic. I'm certified by the Canadian Council of Aviation and Aerospace as a aircraft gas turbine engine overhaul technician. It's quite a long title, whatever. Anyway, so that's what I do. I've been doing that for 25 years, something like that. And we're going to talk about something today that I haven't really dived into. I've bumped up against it here and there, and I've been kind of discouraging it in the comments for the past few years, but I don't know why. So we're gonna look at that right now. And let me just, hang on a second. I'll get the question up on my email. Okay, it wasn't email, it was in the comment section of a couple of videos. An old video, this is unrelated, but I think it's funny and it's fun. So it is fun. The comment was, "Who are you, Mr. Expert?" Now there's no comma in there, so I don't know if it's an attempt to call me out or an insult, or if it's actually a question. So I asked, without punctuation, I can't tell whether you're hostile or not, so why don't you expand on it so I can tell for sure. I'm pretty sure he's hostile because no answer. Anyway, the reason we're here today, we'll back up a couple seconds. I get a lot of that, and I try not to focus on that. I focus on the odd good comment where people like what I do and they're interested, and you guys are the people I make videos for. So this one is interesting, very interesting. And it's gotten more interesting the more I thought about it. It's from Cowie Ninja 6750. So was it a 675? No, it was a 636. But they had Cowie Ninja 600s and Cowie Ninja 750s. And I had a Kawasaki KZ650B2, which I loved and was destroyed in a crash many years ago. Anyway, Cowie Ninja 6750. He asked, question unrelated to this video. And the video was fuel air ratio for jets. A video that I recently put out and almost everybody missed the entire point of the video. In the entire point. 50% of those people were talking about piston engines which have nothing to do with these, nothing at all. And the other 50% missed the point completely. So, whatever. I failed again. Unrelated to this video, in a previous video long ago, you discussed folks finding their own gas turbines for what would be known as for fun. To stand around, drink beer, and fire up in the backyard. I would like to know your opinion on what to look for in these types of barn finds. Almost like a pre-buy inspection, just to have a better idea of what will run or not for the previously mentioned fun. Love the content, keep it up. Well, that's a really cool question, and I've never really given it that much thought, but we're gonna do it now. We're gonna go through an initial orientation session on how you're gonna buy your own jet engine to build and run for fun. There's a few global basics, a couple global variables. The first one being, don't get a big one. Don't get an Avon. This is half of an Avon. There's the turbine right there. The Avon produces 12,000 pounds of thrust, but anywhere between 8 and 15 different models. Very dangerous, very large, terrifying. Even if you get it started, you're going to terrify the entire neighborhood. And if you run it to even half power, you're going to terrify people for miles around. And if you run it at full power, something's going to go wrong with your mount or your stand or whatever. And you're going to terrify the entire town and probably owe millions of dollars in uninsured losses. I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding. Jets from far away on an airplane, they're really cool. Right up close, they make a lot of noise. Sure, they do. They make cool noises, but what they're designed to do is to push, and they push hard. If you were going to rebuild a medium-sized bulldozer and you wanted to have it dig through the earth with its tracks, what would you hold it down with? That kind of thing. So I cringe when I see people with jet engines, smaller ones, on YouTube, and they've got it on a rolling cart, like this thing. Oh yeah, and they've got their fuel pump and their fuel supply and their oil supply and their instruments and their igniters and their, maybe it's a leaf blower to get it started, maybe it's the actual starter, but it's on wheels. Even a medium-sized jet engine's gonna make a couple of tons of thrust. And if it decides to go, the good thing is it's gonna go and it's gonna rip away the fuel line and it's not gonna run anymore. If you put the fuel tank on the cart and you get it up to power and it goes, it's an uncontrolled, self-propelled, very dangerous missile. So anyway, pick a small one, rule number one. Rule number two, what you need is whoever's selling it, or if you've discovered it in a junkyard or in an aviation surplus garbage place, you're not going to find it in a barn because somebody else would have done that first and then they've got their little possession and so they'll know all about it. But you need to have a data plate. So if you see an ad in the social media or any other classified ads for a, let's just say, a Rolls-Royce Viper. Okay, Rolls-Royce Viper is 8 feet long, 6 feet long maybe. It's probably got three thousand pounds of thrust. It's a big hobby engine. They put it in airplanes. It was kind of designed as a missile engine. Anyway, let's say you see one of those and it's $1,500. No, it's probably gonna be 15,000. Anyway, you go, hey, you contact the seller and you say, hey, what model is it? And he'll say, it's a Rolls-Royce Viper. It's like there's many models of Vipers, all with their own idiosyncrasies and differences in design. So, hey, what is it? This is what you need as a minimum. If you don't get this, move on. I'm cautioning you here. If you don't get this and you still continue to ask and pay money for, you're just gonna have a big lump of metal you can look at and say, yeah, it's a Rolls-Royce Viper. Look at that, used to be a jet engine. Now it's a paperweight that weighs 800 pounds on my lawn. Okay, hang on. Okay, I think we have a bit of glare there. That's not bad. Okay, these are what's known as the data plate. A lot of glare. The data plate or the name plate. Maybe some people will call it a badge. If it's missing from the engine, that's not that uncommon because they're kind of cool. These are stainless steel, sort of frosty engraved and embossed, and they're cool. This is the one you want. There's often two on the engine. We'll get to that in a second. The data plate saying what the heck the thing is. And then there's a overhaul data plate or overhaul information. This one is, it's got the serial number for the engine. Doesn't say what kind of engine it is. It's just a recording of what work was done to it. And they're often incomplete because people don't bother to put stuff in. This, the first and the last entry here, it was overhauled in 1958 or March 19th, 1958. I'm not sure what that means. The contractor would be ASB, whoever that is. WID, I don't know what that might be, the instructor, or the inspector. And then an RCAF inspector as well. So all these things, they mean a lot to people who are involved with it, but this is back in the 1950s, and who knows? You don't really want this. This would be nice to have, but this doesn't tell you what you've got. For example, this is a Avon Mark 531B, which I've never heard of. Serial number 30922. It's a civilian airliner engine. FAA type certificate import. So I'm not sure what type of American airliner had Avons in them, but the Caravelle was made in France and it did use Avons, so I don't know. Anyway, very similar, this one over here, is Rolls-Royce England, or Derby in London, England. Derby, England, Derby in London. Avon. Mark, I don't know if you can see this. It says 3253. Well, that's an aviation engine as well. And the serial number is, it's 30127 or something like that. So these are both aircraft engine tags from different models of Rolls-Royce Avon. Those are quite rare. I used to work on Avons 20 years ago, and they were all industrial Avons. And the difference between an industrial Avon and an aircraft Avon is the insides are all the same, with the older ones having identical part numbers. The newer ones, they've kind of tried to distance themselves because aviation engines, once the aircraft is retired, they don't fly anymore. The engines are still in various states of use, and if the part numbers are the same, you could just, if you're an industrial operator, you could buy some decommissioned aircraft engines and a lot of valuable parts in there. You can save literally millions of dollars if you run a few Avons by getting junked Avons, scrapped ones, scrapped because they have no use anymore, and taking out the parts and keeping these running. So the manufacturer doesn't like that because they lose money from selling the industrial replacement parts. So that's why the serial numbers, the part numbers have been changed over the years. And so you've got two parts that don't have the same part number. They might even be identical, but the part numbers are different. And so various things. Your warranty doesn't apply, if there is any warranty. And if you're a super stickler for the rules, which a lot of people are, because these things cost millions of dollars, when you want a 47B, do you want a 1L5? They're the same. The engineer says they're the same. Yeah, but they're a different part number. Should we use them? The owner, the management's going to say no. Get the right parts, even if they are the right parts. Anyway, that's a little spiral out of the subject. So let's get back to this. Okay, kind of an interesting collection here. We've got this is a Canadian built by Arenda J79, which they call, sorry, I gotta look at this too, a J79 OEL7. Okay, and that's the serial number and inspection number and that sort of thing. This is a kind of a rare engine. This was used in the Canadian Starfighters. It's a Canadian built licensed copy of the J79. Yeah. And similar engine. This is a upside down aircraft turbojet engine right there. USAF model GE11E. Customer number, GE serial number. Customer part number, oh, basic engine. Well, this is the basic engine. And then, okay, this is the whole assembly, which would include the afterburner. Get to that in a second. Okay, that's pretty cool. And then where is that? I don't have an afterburner plate for a J79, but I have an afterburner plate for a TF-41. Let me get this out of the bag. Yeah. Oh, no, it's a, let's see. It's blank. Okay, so this can be of anything you want. That's kind of cool. Solid stainless steel. Very collectible. And it was packaged with, might have been off the same engine, Dash 15E, that's from a Phantom. Yeah, and it's got a serial number, but no other information. What's this one? These are quite common in what we deal with. I think we bought a bunch of these for not so much, conversion. We converted some of the engines, but we also disassembled them for parts. And this is this is one of the coolest engines ever. Excuse me. CJ805-23. Right, hang on. So the CJ805 in the 50s and 60s was the civilian version of the J79. The J79 was a hugely powerful engine, and it was a giant leap forward in the jet engine community. And it was a very reliable engine, so they made thousands of them because it was used in a lot of aircraft. The Century series of American fighters, the CF-100, CF-101. Actually, the 100 doesn't really count in the Century series, really. But the other ones did. The 101, the 102, the 104 Starfighter, the 105. The 105 also, anyway, I'm going by engine. So I think it was the 101, the 102, and the 104. They all had J79s, and J79s were in the B-58 Hustler. Anyways, a very popular engine. So civilians had a version of it that didn't have an afterburner. And that was basically a J79, non-afterburning, used in a lot of planes, a lot of airliners. And then, as the idea of the turbofan was discovered or was being developed in the mid-60s, I think. Turbofans moved more air, they were quieter, they were more powerful, and they were more fuel efficient. So, great, right? The 23 was an aft fan, so it was very strange. You took a J79, front is here, and on the back you bolted a thing. What was it? It was a freewheeling, so it was a free power turbine. I don't know how they did this. Anyway, excuse me. Right behind, in the exhaust of the J79, there was another turbine wheel that extracted more power, or whatever power was left, from the exhaust gases. And there's a lot, because a turbojet has a high velocity exhaust. So they put a turbine in that exhaust, which took out a large amount of the energy. But then each of the blades of the turbine, there was the round case it was in, each blade came up there, and there was a space. So there's a slot in there, or the end of the casing. The turbine blade went up to the case, and then it had a shrouded section, and it continued. And there was a big long piece, and that piece was not a turbine blade, it was a fan blade. So it was a turbine with an outer section of fan. It was a turbine fan. A lot of people mix up the word turbine and fan. It's totally incorrect, but in this one special case, it is correct. A fan with an internal section that is a turbine. So a very unique blade. And because we have that data plate, because I have that data plate, means one of them, at least one of them, came to S&S before I did. This place was disassembled for the parts, mostly for the compressor and the shaft and that sort of thing, and the basic engine would have been useful to run the 1500, which is the industrial version of the J79. So that whole aft fan would have been tossed by people looking for this stuff and not that stuff. And of course now, just like if you look around your house, I bet you can't find a film canister. The last film was probably sold in the 90s, maybe the early 2000s. But anyway, film canisters were great, and now they're nowhere because nobody thought about it and they just chucked them out. So these Dash 23 sections, oh man, I would love to have a blade from that. They're such collector's items, and I haven't even checked eBay because I'm not going to buy stuff when I am surrounded by this kind of stuff. But anyway, the Dash 23 is very cool. I feel privileged to have that data plate. Okay, we're going too far. All these engines are too big for your project. Forget all these things, okay? They're at least as big as an Avon, and that's the front half of an Avon, facing front down. Gonna show you a good suggestion. Oh, before we get to what we wanna look for, we had the data plate, the small data plate. Data plate is essential. Because even if you get some unknown thing, and you recognize what it is, do you really want to have a collector's item jet engine toy that doesn't have its nameplate on it? I wouldn't. Anyway, that's like buying a used Rolls Royce missing the spirit of ecstasy. Who doesn't want the spirit of ecstasy? Okay. And you want it to be complete. What do I mean by complete? When engines get sold for scrap or parts purposes, often the starter will be stripped off. We got this Avon with the starter on it. The starter is usually gone. The igniter box, because igniter boxes are, they can work on other engines sometimes, but they're an expensive component that can be swapped around, so it's often missing. Without a starter and an igniter box, you're never going to get that thing running, so you want that. Other things like fuel controls, fuel nozzles. All right, where are we? Rolls-Royce Avon, fuel nozzle. Rolls-Royce Spey, fuel nozzle. I don't have an Olympus one because we didn't have any wrecked Olympuses. LM2500, which is also, it's very similar to the one in the CF6, which is from the A300, one of the world's first wide-body aircraft. Smashing them around, of course. J79 from the 50s. And F404 from the F-18, the FA-18, not the Super Hornet, the regular Hornet. And from the Aranda out of the Sabre jet. Fuel nozzles are cool. If you know how to get them out, they're quite simple. And you take them because you want them. So I'm part of the reason why those things aren't on scrapped aircraft in junk heaps, because I like those pieces and I want them. Anyway, you want to make sure all those things are there, because if you're looking for, and I don't have one, from a J-47, it looks a lot like this, but different. It looks like a space pistol, a Buck Rogers pistol. So they're cool. Let's say you bought a J-47. It's too big, so don't get that one. If you're trying to find a J-47 fuel nozzle, you can find people that have them, but you have to become like in the in crowd. And then you could buy one or two, or they want to sell a whole set. They'll sell you a whole set for what? Minimum $10,000. People are out there asking $10,000 each for them. So you don't want that. You want to have your engine complete, all those things. And no damage. Like, I got a whole pallet of stuff that came off this engine, of stuff that's mangled. Because to pick that engine up, there's all kinds of special handling hardware, and there's also ways, if you know what the engine is, you can pick it up with a forklift and with slings and not damage it. If you don't know what you're doing, you can just slide the forks in, pick it up, and roll it into the forklift, and now you can carry it anywhere you want, and you've done about $100,000 damage in a few seconds. So, undamaged. It shouldn't be smashed up. So it's getting harder to find. Now, we're going to look at some good things that we do want to find, some examples of engines, okay? Okay, I got this from a buddy I'm going to mention in a little while. This is a J-44 built in the early 50s. And so its thrust is 1,000 pounds, or 1,000 pounds, different models. What does it weigh? 355 to 370 pounds. It is 8 feet long and 22 inches in diameter. So a smallish, medium to small engine. This would be on the big side for a hobby engine. This is a really cool book. So yeah, okay, the first engine tested in 1948, built into the 50s. Started off as a missile engine and became an aircraft engine. And look at that, in the wingtips of a Fairchild C-123, the airplane from Air America. So, here we go, and it's got a neat little, this is like a brochure. It isn't going to tell you anything technical about the engine, but it's designed, it does say here, due to simplicity of design and construction, they've successfully operated in spite of heat, sand, and wind, desert-like bases, sub-zero temperatures, so it's easy to fix and maintain. It's perfect for a a hobbyist. Kind of a layout of what it all looks like to give you an idea of what you're dealing with. Centrifugal compressor and axial turbine. Quite simple, very good. It's enough to get you excited that you might need one. J44s do not need costly, complex field maintenance tools and support equipment. That's good too. I like it. I'm liking it more and more. And so anyway, I don't know how many they made. So I don't know how many of those they made, but I would say in the thousands. So, and that was in the 50s, it's a long time ago. Your goal, the hardest part of this whole procedure is finding one. Okay, but they're out there. There's lots and lots of them. There's various sources of information. There's a website that I find difficult to use called WIX, or Warbird Information Exchange. There's also a fantastic weekly, is it weekly? It's a classified, it's an online classified, it's called Barnstormers. It's mostly, it's for the aviation community, and it's got all kinds of mostly light aircraft. But there's categories in there for vintage jets, vintage jet engines, turbine engines. There's not much in there, but that's how things are going to pop up. You have to be in the scene and connected to find the stuff. You got to always be looking, because when something like a J44 pops up for whatever, found it in my grandpa's belongings in his barn in a big wooden crate. It says 1955 J44 offers. You want to be there that day with, I don't know, a couple grand at least. So, finding it. And then, this is a sticking point. You have to be able to get the overhaul manual. Any engine from, the reason I've left out the Allison 250 is because it's a current engine in helicopters. It's a 400 horse engine. It's about this big. I've got one right over there. We'll show that in a second. You need the manual, because that engine, without the actual instructions, you are absolutely certain to wreck it. Okay? Why do people like me even exist? Why do people like me have jobs? Why does a career as an aircraft gas turbine engine even exist? It's because you can't treat it like a 65 Chevelle with a 327. Even an accountant or a baker or an eye surgeon could rebuild a 327, probably without instructions, with a buddy that says, oh yeah, you do this, and here, yeah, do it this way. They're relatively easy. Gas turbines are difficult to work with, and especially that manufacturer, they set little traps for you. And you come up to this trap, you've got to figure out, you've got to do it carefully, and you've got to repair the thing or even overhaul. So it's undamaged but crusty, maybe rusty, full of deposits and stuck together. You've got to restore it to working condition without doing any damage. That's a different type of work than, well, frankly, what I've seen when I've worked as a bicycle mechanic. I've seen people work as vehicle mechanics, and you just can't hack on things. And if there's a special tool, you'll be lucky if they show the special tool in the manual and you can copy it. Make the special tool. Here's a good example right here. I'm just coming closer. This is an Avon fuel nozzle. It does come apart. You see that castellated ring right there? That thing, sort of thing? If you put this in a vise and you just hammer on those square edges with even a soft punch, it's never going to move. First of all, you take this locking ring off, of course. You take the locking ring off. Where is it? There we go. Yeah, it goes into the castellation. But this one has been attempted that way because it's got some chewing hackage on the castellations. Even if you have, okay, this tool was purchased to work on castellated nuts on Rolls-Royce engines, but not these. These are tight. So this is the thing. It's a hook spanner. So the hook goes in there. This one's quite large for the use. It hooks into the thing, and then it'll help undo it. Doesn't work here. The reason it doesn't work here is because this is so tight, you're only pulling on one of the castellations. The special wrench that's on here goes at least halfway around and hooks on about six different castellations, and it barely makes it. So you're gonna need special tooling. Yeah. You're gonna need special tooling, and if you're lucky, and if you're just gonna run at the backyard, drink beer and yee-haw to the northern lights or whatever, you don't need to do a lot of those complex operations. So where are we now? We found an engine, it's small, it's got the data plates, got all the pieces on it, and there's no great damage. So we have to find the overhaul manual, which tells us how to work on it and also how to run it. Because again, it's not a 327. If you hit the starter, give it a bunch of fuel and hit the igniters, you're gonna destroy it. It's gone. Now all your work and all your money is sitting there in a burning pile of metal. So you gotta know how to run it. All right, let's take a look at a good source of manuals. And this is probably a deal breaker. This is an overhaul manual for the, does it even say? It's a J47. Yeah, J47, all these different models. And honestly, if you've got any one of these, or even earlier models of the J47, this will get you 88% to where you want to be, because the engines do have changes, but they're not all that huge. It'll get you oriented. Where did I get it? Let's just open it up and have a nice little look at. Okay, so again, like I told you, the J47 is too big for a single person to do in their garage, because the whole thing's probably, what, 12 feet long, weighs 2,500 pounds. It's one of these. It's the engine in Craig Breedlove's first Spirit of America. The one where he goes, now for my next trick, I'm gonna light myself on fire. That one. Oil diagram. It's got the whole thing, the whole ball of wax. And where's that tool? There was a picture of a tool. We don't need to go there right now. But anyway, it's the whole thing. It is sold at, this is not a paid promotion. I paid for this thing. What did I pay for it? 140 bucks? Something like that? Oh no, I got, oh, these are for, this is a different purchase. I wish I could find that, the Sabre 6 flight manual. I can't find that. And it's a really good book. It's more about the airplane than the engine. But anyway, got it from these guys. eflightmanuals.com, their website, it's fantastic. And a lot of the things I can't get because I live in Canada, Americans can get more manuals. So that's what you want to do. So things are looking up. You're bored with V8s, you're bored with turbocharging Hondas, and you've found an engine. It's complete. It's undamaged, but has an unknown history. It is in stock at eFlight Manuals, and you've bought the manual. So actually, before all that stuff happened, you did your research. You read about different engines, and you thought, is it a Continental J69? It's a J69. I can't remember who makes it. It's about a 2,000-pound thrust engine. 1,500-pound thrust engine. It's a gas turbine that's the size of this table. It's a little big. You decided that's what you want to work on. You're going to need a good set of tools and be ready to design and make, or have a machinist make, special tools that you're going to need. It's complete, undamaged. Got that. You bought the thing. For some reason, you managed to spend less than $50,000 for this thing. You might get lucky and spend 1,200 bucks, but don't count on it. The world is full of people that have ancient aviation stuff, and they think it's worth a fortune. On eBay, there was an ad for years for a development Rolls-Royce Olympus engine. As part of the history of the Olympus engine that powered the Concorde and the Vulcan, it's priceless. They wanted $400,000 American for this thing. As an engine, as a project, as a teaching tool, it's no more valuable than any other piece of junk out there. It's, you know, and as an engine for something, it's way too big for any project you can even think of. If you have a boat that's more than 175 feet long, an Olympus will make it go 80 miles an hour. So it's a huge engine, not suitable for individual participation. So that engine is worthless. I don't know if it's even still out there. You can look up turbine engines on the internet. It's probably out there somewhere. It's beautiful. It either belongs in a museum or as in some kind of display. And it's going to be a tax write-off for whoever buys it because nobody needs it. Nobody needs a 38,000 pound thrust engine for anything. The vehicles that do need an engine with that much power, they have something much lighter, more modern, and much, much, much more expensive. So unfortunately, that person, they think they have a fortune on their hands, they're gonna make $1 million, and they're not gonna get anything because nobody's gonna buy it. What was I gonna say? Yeah, you wanna find the right small engine. So research, research, research. And so now you're on your way. And at that point, you've probably spent somewhere below $50,000 to build the test stand or the display stand or the running stand for anything more than bigger than a J69. You're gonna need a building or a massive complex to support it. So smaller is better. If you really need an actual jet engine that was in an airplane, the J-44, the CJ-610 Pratt & Whitney, but it's about 3,500 pounds of thrust. It's big enough to cause a lot of mayhem. And it's also a somewhat current engine. Whichever engine that you use is going to depend on how resourceful you are and how lucky you are to find something. You find something. And then even if you find it and if they say, look, you know, you're gonna have it if you haul it away. I told somebody the other day that, not the other day, a couple years ago, but they never came by. I had an AI-25, that Russian turbofan, on a stand, and I said, you guys come here and you can take it away. It's all yours. But the thing didn't run. So my camera's battery timed out, actually died, so that's an indication this video is getting pretty long, so I gotta wrap it up. Luckily, I have two batteries, luckily. Okay, so we're talking about price. That's the trickiest part. You've gotta be a detective. You've gotta be Columbo, or what's her name, Elspeth Tassioni. You gotta be her. You gotta get to know people, find out, follow leads. You're gonna find something. Even if there's helicopter overhaul companies and aircraft overhaul companies, ask them. Say, look, I'm just a guy. I'm just a guy that wants to drink beer and run a jet engine in my backyard. Doesn't have to be airworthy. I just need something that I can make run or maybe will run if I clean it up a bit. You got something like that? No. You know somebody that does? Maybe. What's his number? Just go like that and you'll find something. And you'll have to adapt your plan, and you'll get there. And then, so if you're lucky, it turns over. It has a starter. Hit it with a battery. Hey, look at that! It turns. But they say it won't start. Okay. Do not take apart the fuel control system, unless you have the fuel control system overhaul manual. And even then, don't do it. There's all sorts of special tooling, special fasteners, special, and setup. What you could try, what I've seen work, is you get a piece of junk, a royal piece of junk, and you soak it. Soak it for a week in WD-40 and spray it out with cleaner, carb cleaner. Just keep trying to push fluid through it and keep playing with it. Eventually you'll get it to start. But what you need to know, so you don't kill yourself, is you need to know the operating procedure in the manual. So again, now you've found the engine, you got to find out if, sure, you can just get it if it's super cheap or even free as a display, but to get it to run, you absolutely need the operations manual because they're all different. They're all the same and they're all different. And they can become extremely dangerous. So yeah, go to professionals and say, look, I just want to do that. I know it's a silly idea. And they'll laugh because they'll think, well, yeah, I should do that too. Maybe they will. I don't know. But they probably have friends that want to do that. So all the really good, easy, cheap deals on this fantastic thing that nobody wants anymore, the guy's got a buddy that wants it and he's already given it to him. So it's hard to find the thing. I do have an engine like that, the Allison 250. And have I got it running yet? No, because it's literally a basket case. Everything is in boxes. It's also got the parts of a crashed helicopter as spares. And I don't know if I have everything I need, but I'll get to it when I'm really retired. So that one was given to me for nothing. And by a very generous man named Joe in the UK. And the other one that's featured in my videos called the Mini Jet Boat. Yeah, the Mini Jet Boat. It's a 315 horsepower Allison 250 C18. And that engine was in a boat. It exploded and was repaired. And it sat around for 10 years gathering cobwebs. So I asked the owner of this place. I said, can I have it? He goes, sure, take it. It was free. And then I didn't do anything with it for 5 years. So Justin, down the road, he wanted to get it going. So he started overhauling the fuel system and he did more work on it than anybody had for the past 15 years. So I gave it to him for nothing. That sounds crazy. That's the lowest price I know of. And then right after I did that, somebody gave me another one. Why haven't I worked on it? Don't get mad at me. I work on this kind of stuff every day. And that's why I will never build an engine out of a turbocharger because it just doesn't interest me. If you want to have a real engine, you got to find it. How do you find it? It's up to your own resourcefulness and creativity. It's going to be a real hobby. It may take a year or two to find something suitable, but make sure it's small. Make sure it has all the pieces, it's undamaged, and in your amateur opinion, you might be able to get it to run. Well, you look at the starter, it'll say on there, it might say 28 volts. So you get two car batteries, it gives you 24, it's close enough. Hit that starter on the two batteries, and then just for a second, and if it turns, bingo, you're one quarter of the way there. Let's take a look at that right now. Okay, so we've got sort of tool storage and bicycle storage on this little work table I built for it. That's another thing. You'll be lucky if the engine that you want to buy comes in a container. It most likely won't. It'll be sitting on a couple of old tires. And first thing you need to do is to build a work stand. And you've got to understand that they're difficult to lift and move around. And they're expensive and delicate. Is that the best light we've got? That's not too bad. Okay, so here, the air discharge pipes. This is the compressor outlet right here. Has to go to the combustor. I have two of those. Where are they? Here. They don't have gaskets. So we gotta probably make those. They go in there like that. All of the fuel control is missing off here. But it's been mocked up. There's no combustor liner in there. Where's the combustor liner? Right here. Combustor liner. I think it's complete. I think there's enough stuff here to make it work. So I've got a lot of work to do. Why haven't I done it? I don't know. Maybe I'll get to it. It's a big thing. And so I guess that's the last point. Okay, that's my last point. It's going to take enormous patience. If you're used to working on car engines, you've watched Freiberger and Dulcich rebuild a Dodge 340 in a weekend. Are you kidding me? A small turbojet engine, even if it's the 10th one you've done, is going to take a month. So it's the first time you've done it. If you're a professional mechanic of any kind, it's still the first time you've attempted this job. Including the time it's going to take to design and make the tooling you're going to need to do the work, it's going to be months. I would give it a year. You won't be disappointed if you get a small engine like the 250, smaller than the 250. The J44 is physically bigger, but it's far simpler. One of those, give yourself a year working on it for a couple hours every day, and you might get close to running it. If you don't have that kind of patience, you're gonna go nuts, and you're gonna stop halfway through because it's so incredibly boring. Okay, so to cap this off, exactly what you wanna do, if you wanna do that, has been done several times. The guy that gave me the J44 brochure, his name's Darren Duncan, DD. He is on YouTube with many videos about his J44 resurrection project, and he's built a really nice running stand for it with instrumentation. The minimum instrumentation you need is engine RPM, oil pressure, and exhaust gas temperature. You must have those three. If there's many more you could use that you would make it nice, but without those three, you're putting yourself in danger, and you need to know what the limits are for those things. There's no sense having a temperature probe in the exhaust and running it to 2,000 degrees, having it explode in molten metal and burning your house down. Then you're just knowing by how much you're exceeding the operating temperature if you only knew the operating temperature. So yeah, I wish you luck, but it's going to take money and time and a lot of ingenuity and effort. The more effort and ingenuity and time you spend, the less money you'll spend. Of course, you could buy any of these. You could buy a Williams turbofan that's only this big with, I think, 400 pounds of thrust. I think it's like $650,000. Go get them, if they'll send one to you. They're using cruise missiles. So I wish you great luck. It's not an impossible thing to do, but it is up there. You know, and I've got a book on my BMW bike, and it's got these little symbols for levels of difficulty, up to 5 wrenches. One is super easy. 5 is recommended for professionals only. Any small turbojet engine that you, whoever you are, want to get as a hobby and run it for fun, it's about a 7 on that scale. It's not impossible, but it takes patience and resolve, resourcefulness. You can do it. But it's a project that's not done very often for a very good reason. It's a big job, but it's not impossible. I do that here every day, but see, I know that it's gonna result in some kind of reward besides just running the engine. I'm gonna get paid for it. So if you're doing it as a hobby, you better really, really want it, because you don't wanna spend $25,000 and get halfway and stop, and then it's just something that's sitting there in the corner of your shop, like my Allison 250. I'll finish that soon. Anyway, on this glorious weekend, thanks for watching. Okay, in the J47 book, there we go. We're recording. All right, in the J47 book, the overhaul manual, there's this picture. Turbine rotor suspended. See that? Funky tool. Funky. Okay, there's a thread on the back of the turbine wheel that takes a cup that is supported on a bracket during shipping. So when the engine's running, that thread is just, it's an external thread, it's just sitting there. Alright, remember that. So when we were gonna overhaul the J47 engine, it's actually an industrial engine. An industrial version of it, we were just gonna give her, but I went and spent the $100 or whatever it was for that manual there, and it actually came as a PDF. I got it printed, bought the binder. It was worth every penny, because the J47, while being a very simple engine, has all of the accessories that are normally on the outside of a modern engine. Well, these have all been stripped off, but you know what I'm saying when you see the engines in here. All that stuff is in the nose, because that was an engine back in the day when the main rotating shaft through a gear ran a gearbox, and you just attached all the stuff you needed on that gearbox. Then you put a big nose cone over it, and there's your engine, nothing on the outside. That's the way they did it, because they didn't know any better. They literally didn't know any better. Anyway, all that stuff projects well forward of the engine, and there doesn't need to be any huge support on the front. The front is just sheet metal that directs the air into the engine. Anyway, there's four major struts that go out to the outer casing, and each of those four struts, all sheet metal, they've got many lines between four and six hydraulic, electrical, fuel, oil lines going through them. It's incredibly complicated, and it's sheet metal, so it will not support the weight of the engine. So in order to turn the engine vertical, to set it on a stand so you can get to the stuff to take it apart, you need a crane anyway, right? It literally took working 6.5 hours a day, and I had the instructions. This is the first one we did. It wasn't that book, it was a different one. It took me more than a week of work to get all that stuff off, and so we got back to the part where you take off all the accessories, take off the gearbox, you can rest the engine on some wood so that it's vertical so you can reach in through the back and take out, for example, the turbine. Then I saw that picture and I'm thinking, that thing's balanced. And if we can disconnect, we can disconnect the turbine by turning it. It's threaded it's actually not threaded. It goes in, it's a big tube, and there's a big long bolt coming out, and you put the nut on the end, and that holds it together. So you take off that nut, and if you had that tool, you can have the engine in horizontal, leave all that weeks of work with the complicated fuel system, oil system, everything up front, leave it there, don't even touch it, stick that tool in, or actually it goes on to the external thread on the turbine, it comes up like this, and right there, that's the balance point for the turbine. So I put a micro adjustment on mine so you could adjust the balance. I built a copy of the tool just because of that picture. And we had a J47 in here, and I just pulled out. It was that one with the broken turbine blade. We left everything alone, saved weeks of work, and just pulled out with the tool held by the crane, pulled out the turbine shaft and disc as one. It was all balanced, just popped right out. It was like magic. So right there, that saved weeks of work. That's not why you need the manual, but that's another benefit of the manual, because it can save you huge amounts of time. If you don't have the manual, you're not going to do things properly, because it tells you what to do exactly step by step every single bit of the way. And if you don't follow that, disaster. When I was in school, when I was in jet school, when I was in Jedi school, that's the first 2 weeks of school. It weeds out the non-suitables. The projects are all about, you get a book, it's got 10 pages of instructions. If you follow those instructions, it all works. And if you think you're super smart because you've worked on Chevys before, not picking on Chevy, whatever, Briggs & Stratton, Yamaha, Honda, Mako, whatever engine you were working on, if you think you know better than the manual and you say, well, I'll just skip ahead to step 8. We'll just do that. We'll just do that. Those guys, they always failed because they either broke something or got themselves into a position where the instructor had to come and say, okay, you've got to go back from where you are and start at the beginning, and then it'll succeed. Right now you're stuck and you cannot get out of this situation except by going backwards. So yeah, that's the main thing. If you follow the procedure, which is in the book, you have some chance of success. If you decide to wing it and let's take these off first and then see if we can look inside there and pry that out, You're guaranteed to fail.
Okay, I don't have the mic this time because I'm not going to get it all together again after putting it away for the third time. But this is a special message. If you're a young guy or girl and you want to do this, and let's say you get a J44 or a whatever, Rolls-Royce Viper, this, that, whatever, T58 even. It's going to be a huge project, but if you just do it out of self-interest and you do all the work and the research and the reading, making the tools, using the tools, getting the thing running, and it runs, you take a video of that thing, and you go apply for a job at GE or Pratt & Whitney or any aircraft overhaul place, and you might be 25 by now, and you did that project. And you tell the guy, yeah, I did that. And they're going to go, you did that. And you go, yeah, and you show them the video. And they're going to ask you a few questions to see if they can figure out if you're lying or not. And if they think you did that by yourself, it's like, holy shit, man, which job do you want? I'm serious. Okay, thanks for watching.